Welcome back to CinemaScoop. If you're into suspenseful survival movies with crazy plot twists, today's video is the one for you. Join us as we recap the utterly gripping thriller Fall. Spoilers ahead. The movie begins with a group of three mountain climbers. Becky is afraid of falling, but her husband Dan encourages her. He tells her that she's been through scarier things and that she can manage jumping over to him. He catches her when she does, and while they kiss, their friend Hunter tells them to get a room. They continue to ascend, and Dan is about to hook his anchor into a hole when a bird flies out and scares him. He loses his footing, but before he can properly get a grip on the surface, the other anchor loosens and he falls to his death. 51 weeks later, we learn that Becky's worried father, James, has been trying to get in contact with her. She's sitting at a bar drinking and calls Dan's number to hear his voice on his voicemail. As she walks out of the bar, she sees James leaning on her car. He tells her he had no choice but to show up since she refuses to speak to him. She admits to ignoring his outreach because she's hurt by his harsh words against Dan, as he doesn't believe Dan loved or cared for her. James tells her he wants to see her move on since she knows that if the roles were reversed, Dan wouldn't have sulked about her death for long. She refuses to engage in the conversation anymore and tries to leave, but he doesn't let her drive because she's drunk. He offers to give her a ride, but she walks home instead. She arrives in tears and calls Dan again, only to find out that his number has been disconnected. Feeling like there's nothing left to live for, Becky empties a bottle of pills on the counter and is about to down them when Hunter calls her. Hunter comes over, and they see each other for the first time since the incident. She tells Becky she needs a partner for a big climb she's about to embark on. She confesses to speaking with James, who didn't know who else to call to help Becky. She pitches the climb of the B-67 TV tower and proposes that Becky could scatter Dan's ashes on top. The tower is 2,000 feet high and used to be the tallest structure in the US but is no longer in use. Becky refuses out of fear, and Hunter tells her she'll always be afraid if she doesn't confront her fears. She still turns it down, and Hunter consoles her as she cries. In the morning, she's had a change of heart after staring at Dan's picture, and she agrees to go. They take a 6-hour drive to a diner near the tower, and on the way, Hunter shows Becky an old video of her. Becky continues swiping through the gallery until she finds a photo of Hunter with a man's hand on her shoulder. Becky asks who it is, but Hunter tells her she can't remember. She ignores another call from her dad, and they stop at a diner for food. Hunter shows Becky her new YouTube channel since she's decided to monetize her adventures. Becky encourages her to be herself more on camera, but Hunter refuses. Becky calls the waitress to ask if she could charge her phone, but is turned down. Hunter asks her where the tower is since she can't find it on the map, and the waitress points out the window to a light high up in the sky, stating that they won't need a map to find it. Becky questions why it has a light on since Hunter said it was a decommissioned tower, and she tells her that it's for aircraft to see it. In a dream, Becky tells Dan he loves her, but he doesn't say it back. Instead, he says 143 while tapping the numbers onto her side. She reaches to touch his hand but sees blood on the sheets and jolts out of her sleep. She gets ready and meets Hunter at her car outside their motel. As they're leaving, Hunter films content for her YouTube channel about their climb, but almost drives into an oncoming truck. They head to the tower but meet a locked gate with a no trespassing sign. They jump the fence and walk the rest of the way while checking if they have all the essentials. Hunter doesn't bring any food since she believes they'll be back by lunchtime. On the way, they see vultures feasting on a deer that's still alive. They scare away the birds, and Hunter posts a photo of the animal with a comedic remark that receives many likes. When they reach the tower, they stare at it, trying to take in its height. Becky is visibly afraid and starts to panic slightly. Hunter films as she tells the audience that their journey will begin with an 1,800-foot ladder climb within the tower, then another 200-foot climb on an external ladder before they reach the top. Becky tries to back out, but Hunter tells her that she pushed through when Dan died to overcome her fear, and she believes that Becky can do the same. Hunter hooks a rope to Becky and begins to climb. Becky hesitates as she holds on to the rusty, shaky ladder, but reluctantly begins climbing as well. As they ascend, we see the tower shaking. A bar from the ladder breaks off, and as Becky watches it fall, Hunter checks to make sure she's okay. Becky admits that she's not, but continues to climb anyway, and we see a loose bolt shaking out as the ladder wobbles. When they're halfway up, they stop so that Becky can rest and have a drink of water. Hunter spots the diner far in the distance, and they begin their climb again. We continue seeing the potential hazards on the tower. They reach the end of the internal ladder, and as Becky looks out at the landscape, she freezes and refuses to go any further. Hunter again encourages her, and she starts to climb the 200-foot external ladder. Becky looks down and freezes up again, so Hunter tells her to concentrate on something else to distract her, and she sings a nursery rhyme. There are communications dishes in the way, and when Hunter tells her this will make the climb harder, Becky pleads to go back down. Hunter refuses to let Becky allow fear to win and keeps climbing upwards. She squeezes herself behind the dish to make it to the other ladder and helps Becky do the same by pulling up on the rope. Hunter shakes the ladder to scare Becky. not realizing that a bolt fell out because of this. Hunter makes it to the top and pulls Becky up as the loose ladder shakes and the last remaining bolt falls out. They both take in the view, and Hunter records them at the top with a drone. She gives Becky the controls and orders her to film as she hangs off the platform against Becky's better judgment. She pressures Becky into doing the same, stating that the old Becky would have done it. She convinces Becky that it will help her overcome her fears, and Becky reluctantly agrees. She hangs off the tower while holding Hunter's hand as Hunter snaps photos of her. Their hands start slipping, but Hunter pulls her up before she falls. She tells Becky to look at the photos as a reminder whenever she feels fear again and says that Dan would be proud of her. Becky reaches for Dan's ashes and says sweet words to him before she empties the bag. This makes Hunter cry, and she tells Becky that the reality of his death is only just hitting her now. Becky tells her it's time to go back down, and they put on their harnesses. Hunter helps her down first, but as she descends, the ladder falls backwards, causing a ripple effect that makes the rest below fall as well. In the heat of the situation, neither of them notices that the bag has also fallen. Becky swings from the rope, and Hunter wraps the other end of the rope around the pole to help with the weight. She struggles to pull Becky up and loses grip on the rope, causing Becky to fall back down. Hunter tries again, and this time Becky is able to reach the remaining piece of the ladder and climb up to the platform. They laugh at how crazy that was, and Hunter says she wished she'd filmed it. Becky suggests getting back on the ground, but as they look down, they finally notice that the ladder is gone. Hunter expresses that there's nothing on the pole that they can get a good foothold on, and they realize that they're stuck. Neither of them can get a signal, and Hunter tries to calm Becky down when she begins to panic. Becky notices an emergency box, and they open it to find binoculars and a flare gun. She sees that their supply bag has landed on a communications dish below and believes they'll die of thirst. Hunter denies this and tries to convince her that someone must have heard the loud noises when the ladders crashed to the ground and will call 911. She then notices a deep gash on Becky's leg that she couldn't feel because of her adrenaline rush. When Becky notices it, she panics and winces as Hunter uses her shirt as a tourniquet. As they sit and wait for help to come, Becky questions why Hunter started vlogging. She confesses that Dan's death made her realize that life is short and fleeting, so she's doing things that make her feel alive. It's been 5 hours at the top of the tower, and Hunter spots an RV in the distance. Becky expresses that help would have been there already if someone had called. Hunter has an idea to extend her phone downwards by rope in hopes of picking up a signal, since there may be too much interference with the broadcast antenna on the platform. She types in a message for help and extends the rope as far as it can go. After not hearing a notification sound, Hunter decides to hang off the ladder to lower the phone further. This still fails, and Becky suggests trying an egg drop method. They put the phone in Hunter's shoe and pat it to cushion the fall. They drop it, but it's too far to see and it shatters without their knowledge. When Becky looks down, she notices the vultures circling below. Hunter continues to look around with the binoculars, and Becky notices a 143 tattoo on Hunter's foot. Just then, Hunter spots a man walking below, and they try to call out to him. He's too far to hear them, but the dog does. Becky throws both of her shoes, and one of them hits a fallen ladder. The man and his dog return to the sound, but after looking around, he brushes it off as nothing and leaves. Becky is about to fire the flare, but Hunter tells her not to since the man isn't looking. Through the binoculars, she sees a man setting up a grill by the RV, and since they only have one shot to fire the flare, she suggests waiting until the sun goes down to do it. Becky goes through her gallery and watches a wedding video of her dancing with Dan, but she notices Hunter in the background, unhappily staring at them. Hunter tells her to fire the flare, but the gun jams. Eventually, she gets it to work, and when the men see it, Hunter waves her phone light and the men finally spot them at the top of the tower. They drive the RV over to the locked gate, but instead of trying to help, they break into Hunter's car and steal it. While Hunter looks at Becky's wound, Becky notices the 143 tattoo again, and she tells Hunter that that's what Dan used to say to her instead of "I love you." She asks how long they've been having an affair behind her back, to which Hunter responds 4 months. She tries to apologize, but Becky doesn't accept it. In the morning, Becky asks who made the first move, and Hunter tells her that Dan did. She reiterates that it was a mistake and she tried hard not to fall in love with him, but Dan made her feel a way that no man ever could. She called off the affair after realizing how messed up the situation was when Becky asked her to be her maid of honor. She confesses that it was hard seeing them together, and after Dan died, she didn't have the strength to be there for her, which is why she left. She apologizes again, but Becky doesn't respond. Later, Becky removes the ring from her finger and attaches it to her necklace. An alarm goes off, and Becky states it's been 24 hours since she said it the day before. Hunter suggests dropping her phone as well, but Becky refuses. Becky believes they could have used the drone to get help, but it's also in the bag. Hunter offers to try to reach it as she believes the rope is long enough. Becky doesn't think it's a good idea, but Hunter does it anyway and apologizes again for the affair before descending. When she reaches the end of the rope, she realizes that it's not long enough, She unhooks herself, hoping to get lower, but that also fails. She decides to let go and jump onto the communications dish, but eventually realizes that she can't reach the rope to get back. She attaches a clasp to the bag, hooks it onto the loop of the rope, and then jumps on the bag. Becky tries to pull the rope up as Hunter climbs, but before she can reach the ladder, her foot slips and she falls backwards. Becky is hesitant to look over the platform, but when she does, she's relieved to see Hunter still holding on. The rope has wounded Hunter's palms, and she's no longer able to climb. Becky tries again, and this time successfully pulls Hunter back up onto the platform. She writes a note on the receipt from the diner and attaches it to the drone. As they send it off to the diner, they realize that the battery is almost dead, and unfortunately must bring it back before it dies. Later that night, she has a bad dream of vultures attacking her. Then she sees them eating Hunter and jolts out of her sleep. Hunter assures her that she's safe and just had a bad dream. Becky has an idea to use the light to charge the drone, and they wait until morning to try. As she climbs, she almost gives up from the pain in her leg. Eventually, she makes it and uses her shirt to remove the hot cover on the light, but the prongs are too short to reach. Hunter suggests inserting a metal to carry the current, and Becky uses her ring to do it. As she waits for it to charge fully, a vulture flies around and picks at her. The bag drops, but Hunter makes no effort to catch it. The bird continues to torment her, but she holds strong until the drone is fully charged. They wait until 10 a.m. when their motel is the busiest due to checkout. Becky stares at her dad in the background of a wedding photo and realizes that he was right about Dan all along. She regrets her behavior towards him when he was only trying to help her. As she expresses her apology to him out loud, she begins to fade from weakness. To try to keep her mind occupied, Hunter questions her about things she and her dad love to do together. She talks about watching WWE with him and how he always used to comment on her fighting spirit. At 10 a.m., they send out the drone. It almost makes it to the motel but is destroyed by an oncoming truck. The driver doesn't bother to pick it up, and Becky cries as she realizes her last shot at getting help has failed. Later that day, they see a storm headed their way, and Becky believes she won't be able to make it through the night. She wants to sleep, but Hunter advises against this since the vultures can smell her wound and are waiting to attack. Becky suggests dropping her phone in the shoe with better padding this time. She asks Hunter for her shoe, but Hunter says she can't give it to her because the shoe isn't up there with them. Becky disagrees as she looks over at the shoe on Hunter's foot, and Hunter shockingly reminds her that her body is down below. She looks over to Becky, and we see a terrible wound on the side of her face as she tells her she never caught the bag when she fell. She landed on the communications dish and died from the impact. We find out that Becky has been hallucinating since she couldn't handle the death of Hunter as well. She looks over the platform to see the vultures feasting on Hunter's dead body. Becky cries while the storm rages behind her and records a goodbye video to her father as she tries to hold on to the pole through the storm. We see her dad still trying to get in contact with her. He's unaware of her current situation. Becky appears to be dead as a vulture lands next to her. It closes in, and when it begins eating away at her wound, she grabs it and tussles with it before eventually killing the bird. She eats bits and pieces of it, and when she regains energy and strength, she ties the rope to the last bar of the ladder and lowers herself to Hunter. She has a stare-off with the vulture, expecting it to fight, but it flies away. She sobs as she expresses her love to Hunter. After sending a message to her father asking for help, she stuffs her phone into the shoe. Then she does the unthinkable, stuffing the shoe into a hole in Hunter's stomach. Using Hunter's body to cushion the fall of the phone, she pushes Hunter off the dish. It strains under her weight, and she holds on in hopes that her dad gets her message. Later, we see her father rushing to the scene as her phone successfully picked up a signal. Emergency services have already arrived, but he begins to fret, thinking that Becky is dead when he sees them zipping up a body bag. She sees him from the back of an ambulance, and she calls him. They embrace each other as she apologizes, but he only cares about her being okay and takes her home. As the movie ends, we hear her express her commitment to using every moment of life to do something that makes her feel alive. Subscribe to CinemaScoop so you never miss the latest movie explanations, reviews, and analyses. Thanks for watching.